Grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I want to thank you for your hospitality in inviting me back to St. Stephen's Church in St. Paul to share with you some information, to share perhaps some of the Spirit that will enable you to enjoy the wonderful life of Christian faith as that life gets active and assists people who are without the means to sustain their own life, but to do so not just simply as some do-gooders, some bleeding hearts, if you will, but rather intentionally, very, very, very specifically intentionally as people of Christ. People who have been redeemed by Christ the Crucified, people who stand beneath the cross of Christ and say, yes, that's my Lord who went the way of the cross for me, in whose name I trust for my eternity, in whose name I trust for the great gifts of the Spirit, of hope and love and patience and understanding, so that I can be the person of God that God himself has created me to be, has redeemed me to be, and who sanctifies me to be as well. I'm very glad, particularly, to be at St. Stephanus. I have some family ties here that go back a long way. I'm trying to visualize my Aunt Elsie and my Uncle Ernst, who were married at this church sometime, I guess, in the early 30s. And there's just a whole lot of story behind that wedding that just makes me very proud to be part of that family. And quite interestingly enough, we're going to be having a family reunion in Southern Maryland next weekend, where the grandchildren and the sons and daughters and grandchildren and great-grandchildren of that marriage that took place here some 60, 70 years ago will be there present. And they're going to be very happy that I can say to them, yes, I was at St. Stephen's Church last weekend, and they are buried over here in Elmhurst Cemetery. So anyway, there's a sense of deja vu about all of that. But I'm here not as a family person, except as a family person of the family of Christ. And that's what brings me, as a retired pastor of the church, into your presence and onto your radar screen today. I retired as a pastor of the church. All of my ministry, having been in South Florida, Miami, and the Florida Keys, and Fort Lauderdale, where incidentally I became good friends with a guy named Jim Bailey, who was pastor at St. Mark's Church in Hollywood. So we kind of thought alike, I think, in a lot of ways, and had some degree of friendship. But after retiring as a parish pastor, I said, okay, Lord, what's next for me? What's on your mind? And through a whole series of events and circumstances and whatever, this whole vocation, this whole idea of devoting life and ministry to advocating and begging on behalf of the poor came into focus for me. I'm kind of like, in a way, Amos and the Old Testament prophet who was asked, you know, what are you all about? And Amos said, I used to be a shepherd. I used to be a trimmer of sycamore trees, but God has called me to speak his word to his people. And so that's kind of where I'm at. The word that I want to speak to you is a word of ministry. It's a word that has to do with the person of Christ who became incarnate for us, who became hungry for us, who became naked for us on the cross. I don't know, I was thinking yesterday about that whole word of nakedness that out of Matthew 25, Jesus says, inasmuch as you have clothed the naked, you have clothed me. And I was thinking of Jesus on the cross and how totally exposed and how totally vulnerable he was, simply because he had nothing to wear. He became that poor
for us.
He became hungry for us. In the Garden of Gethsemane, he hungered, he sweated drops of blood because of the anxiety that was there. In the 40 days in the wilderness, he became hungry and tempted for us. That whole idea that God, Creator, became a human being on our behalf, but just not a wealthy kind of middle-class Minnesotan or Floridian, but became a poor person for us. It's interesting that in the Gospel of Luke, all of the parables have to be an emphasis on the poor. The poor woman who lost the coin. The father who lost his son. It's interesting that Matthew has Jesus being born amidst the wealth and pomp and circumstances of the wise men. Luke sees it differently. Luke sees it exciting that the angels came not to the wealthy, but they came to the poor outside the city. The people that were too just not wanted to be in public society, hung around with stinky and smelly sheep. Jesus says, inasmuch as you have loved the poor, you've loved me. Whoa, how to get your mind around that? How to get your mind around that fact that as you look around you and you see poor people, do you see Jesus? Do you see Jesus? For inasmuch as you have loved them, you've loved me. In your bulletin, or at least in this part of the bulletin, I'm not sure how all this gets connected, but I'm sure everyone got one of these. You have this little piece of information with this little girl on top of it, on the cover. I'd like to ask you to get that out, because I want to talk to you about some really poor people. People who are not like people in the U.S., mildly disadvantaged, but people who are stressed with no resources whatsoever. What I mean by that is that, you know, if somebody falls over on the street out here and has a heart attack and as they're walking or something like that, somebody very quickly will call 911. And 911 will respond with an ambulance, and that ambulance will take that person to a trauma center or to a local hospital for treatment. You know what happens in downtown Port-au-Prince in Haiti if that same event occurs? Nothing. People step over the person without a thought. It's just a natural course of event. That's poor. That's poor. You heard the news, I'm sure, of recently in Honduras, where the government, a coup took place. We kind of thought, I guess, all of us that those days of the Banana Republic were over, but here comes another coup. And who takes the hit for that? The poor. The poor people who live in rural villages, who live in, and if you open this up, you see the kind of conditions that they live in, who live in houses like this, who have no hope of ever having anything other than that, whose expectations are only that perhaps a hurricane will not blow this place down and cause injury to their children or to themselves, who are indeed hungry, like this little child here, who are indeed in need of health care because there is no health system that's going to help them. If you open this up all the way, you see this little map of the Caribbean Rim. And these are the countries that are served by Food for the Poor in the name of Jesus. Our whole purpose in life at Food for the Poor, which is an ecumenical ministry that that provides food and houses and developmental assistance so people can learn how to make money and have a job